This is just a short video on limits, specifically how we will use limits in MAT 263 brief calculus. So in this video, I will address these questions: what is a limit, what is limit notation, how do we work with limits in Excel, and how do we work with limits algebraically. Why don't you go ahead and get your lab manuals out, because midway through the video we will look at some of the examples in the lab manual. Alright, so what is a limit? A limit is the value that a function approaches as we get close to a given input value from values above it and values below it. For a limit to exist, the value must be the same as we approach it from both sides. So one of the things I want you to think about here is simply, let's just take a look at a little graph. So if this is the graph of our function f of x, suppose that right here we know that our x value is 4, and we know that our f of x value at that point is 12. Basically, what we're saying is that as we approach that value 4 from values below it, values below 4 is written with 4 and a little negative sign, and values above it, we can certainly see that our function value is approaching 12. Notice we would be coming in through x. Our values of f of x are increasing. At x is equal to 4, they're 12, and even if we came in from the opposite direction. Well, that leads me to the idea of what does limit notation look like. Limit notation for this one that we've just done would be, we would say that the limit of our function f of x as x approaches 4 is equal to 12. Okay, let's take a look at one in Excel. If you take a look at this function that I've written, f of x is equal to x cubed minus 1 over x minus 1. Oftentimes we look at the limits as we approach a value that's not actually in the domain of the function. If you look at the domain of this function, it should be pretty darn clear that x cannot equal 1, because if x is equal to 1, that denominator would be equal to 0. But suppose we wanted to know the limit of f of x as x approaches 1. What I've done for you is I've just taken a snapshot of what I've done in Excel. And what I want you to look at for a second, and you can certainly pause the video and see what I've done here, but I typed my function into Excel. My x values that you can see starting with 0, going, you know, closer and closer to 1, and then on the other side of 1, getting larger than 1, but in very small increments. You can see that at 0.999, the value of the function is 2.997. You can also see that the value at 1.001 on the other side of 1, larger than 1, is 3.003. Well, we could get closer to 1 on either side. We could put in 0.999999, and we could put in 1.000001. What's happening there is on either side of the function, those values are approaching the same number. So we would say the limit of f of x as x approaches 1 is equal to 3. In this one, it's just another example. I've done exactly the same thing for you. Certainly pause the video and go ahead and practice typing it in. In a lot of these examples, you're going to want to make sure that you have your parentheses in the correct place. But here, we're looking at, well, what would the limit be as x approaches 0? Because 0 is something excluded from the domain. The limit of this one is going to be 2. But go ahead, look at it, type it in Excel, see if you need some practice with it. Okay, so this is the answer sheet, actually, for page 19 in your lab manual. And the reason that I put it here is I wanted to just talk about what we do with the lab manual so that you would be able to practice these on your own. If you take a look at what I've done here, this is basically each and every one of those tables in our lab manual just completely filled in with the formulas. And it's pretty clear that in all of them, you're going to decide whether the limit exists or not. Just because you have division by 0, that does not mean the limit doesn't exist. You're looking on either side of that value, and you can see that there is certainly going to be a convergence onto the same number in all of these, except for when you get to the last one, number 6, it doesn't look like those two values are going to converge on the same number. So what we would say there is simply that the limit does not exist. So these are a couple from page 20, and the only thing that I really wanted to talk about here is, can you do limits algebraically? Well, you know, sometimes you can simply just evaluate a limit and get a number. For example, in number 2, I can simply, there's no reason why I can't plug in 1 for x. If I say the limit as x approaches 1, and I just plug in 1 minus 1 squared, well, that's equal to 0. And I was able to just plug that in algebraically and get that value. But in one like this, number 8, I would not be able to plug that in. I could not plug in a 2. So there's a couple of things that I could do there. One of the things that I might want to do is I might want to factor and reduce and then plug in 2. That's certainly a possibility. The other thing that you can do with some of these is you can simply just put them in Excel again. But you're basically evaluating the function. You will always have the opportunity to use Excel if you need to. So these are just the answers from the ones on that page before, page 20, where we were kind of looking at them algebraically. And for the most part, you can simply see that they were just evaluated. We could either plug the value in, use easy algebra, maybe we needed to factor and reduce. But on 6 and 7, the two that I said that there was, the limit does not exist, you could see in those, even as we evaluate closer to the limit that we're looking at, we were looking at the limit as x approaches 3 and number 6, and those values on either side of 3, 696 and negative 7004, certainly aren't the same. And then the same thing here. Okay, so this is the last part of the lab manual. I picked a couple of the application ones that we could look at. Number 4, the concentration in nanograms per milliliter of a 360 milligram dose of a blood pressure medication in a patient's blood during the 24 hours after the drug is administered is described by the function. And I've given you a piecewise function there where H is the time in hours. And I've asked you to find the limit as the hours approaches 10. So we're looking at 10 hours. And there I've added if it exists. Because the whole idea is, well, limits, if they exist at a value, they have to be the same as we approach it from the left and from the right. And then I've asked you to interpret it. Well, I've already included the answers here because the answers are all available to you, and I just wanted to talk about what the answer is saying. if you look at this, all I've done is I've set up a piecewise function in Excel that does the function C of H. And so I've gotten very, very close to 10 from values below it. And then I've gotten very, very close to 10 from values above it. And what's happening here is we can see that that concentration is converging on the same value, 380. So we can say there, as the time approaches 10 hours after the drug is administered, the concentration levels will approach 380 nanograms per milliliter. If you look at number 5, it's a similar type of problem with the piecewise function. Here we're looking at the limit as D approaches 10 of P of D, and this is a price per dive. And this one's interesting because what's happening is as we approach 10 dives again, and we're going to approach 10 from values below it, that's our 9.99, so to speak, and 10 from values above it. Well, what's happening there is you can look, and at values below it, we're at, oh, about 800, right? 799.95. At 10 exactly, we're at 780, and then above 10, we're at 780. So what we basically have to say is that the limit at 10 does not exist, because those values coming in from values below and values above are not the same. You know, I've put the little annotation at the bottom in the notes, and you can go ahead and read that too, just to make sure that you understand how that would affect the context of the problem. One last one to look at is number 6 in that application section. Mold can grow very quickly in a damp area. Let M be the square feet of mold in a damp area and T be the number of weeks since the mold was discovered. Then the growth can be modeled by the function below. So I've given you the function, and I've asked you to find the limit of M of T as T approaches 0 and interpret the results in this situation. So the answer itself we can define by trying to figure out what's going on with the problem. So we know at 0, that's 0 weeks, no time, right, has passed, but we're looking here at what happens as soon as we set up our information. And as soon as we set up our information, we can see that we get a value for this function as soon as we put 0.0001. You can start seeing function values there. So essentially what we're saying is there was approximately, you know, 300 square feet of mold at the beginning of that week, right? So by the end of the week, we can see how many square feet of mold there are. But to start the week with, that's what this 300.02 would represent. I hope this short video has helped. Please feel free to ask questions via email, or during my office hours or in class. Good luck.